Well, thank you so much, LIA, for having me. You know, I wish I get to see all the creative liaison in Las Vegas, but I think half of you guys will be there and half of you guys join this session. So thank you so much for being here today. So let me share screen. All right. Okay, so a little bit, I want to formally introduce myself. My name is Pum Lefebure, like Puma without an A. I'm the co-founder and chief creative officer of Design Army. Design Army is a full service design centric agency in Washington, DC. And you know, everything that we do for the client, as you can see, I'm not sure you guys been to our website, is always, you know, have a design driven solution. Today, my topic of discussion is undeniable, creating images that can't be ignored. So a little bit about myself. I was born and raised in Bangkok, Thailand. And since I was very young, I was like obsessed with drawing and painting. And I my parents was like, you know, she's just going to grow up to be an artist. My favorite toy growing up was a set of color pencil. You know, I can draw and paint all day long. And I knew, like, since I was in kindergarten that, you know, when I grow up, I'm going to be an artist. I told my mom all the time. Fast forward to my high school year, I saw this ad and it's kind of like turned, you know, I kind of changed my mind to dream of become a artist. Because when I first saw this ad by United Colors of Benetton, I was like shocked. I didn't know what it was. I knew that United Colors of Benetton was a clothing brand. And but it's like the first time in my life I look at it, it's like, wow, this is like art. They have something to say. And I did you know, kind of research, you know, what is this thing called? I didn't even know what advertising was exactly, but I never seen anything like this. And I thought, you know, what a way to communicate the brand, right? United Color of Benetton, you have people united together, the kiss, you know, the nun kissing the priest, you have like three raw heart and it's a white, black, and yellow. I mean, this is back in the 90s, like way ahead of its time. And, you know, I thought, okay, whatever this is, I want to do it for a living. So I did a research and this guy named Tibor Carmen, who run a design agency in M&Co. And he was a graphic designer. And that was inspired me to study graphic design in college. So fast forward to my career, I work at one agency before starting my own. And I started my own agency with my husband. And in my 20s, actually, and we thought, you know, we were going to like try to do something cool in Washington. And if it doesn't work out, we can go find another job. And I guess it did work out. I have my business almost 20 years. This is my office. I work from home now. And once in a while, I go, you know, in there to clean up. But since pandemic, I've just been working from home. What I'm trying to, you know, during 20 years career of Design Army, I try to make sure whatever I do, you know, I do focus on the business side, but I don't ever want to lose track of the creative side. So I have this habit of always taking a lot of photos. You know, wherever I go, my phone is my 33rd body part. Like I take a picture of everything. Like, you know, recent trip to Europe, or this is one, the one that I went to in Japan. And what it is that it's really important for us to try to find a sort of inspiration. You know, if you're a copywriter, you might like to, you know, write things down. And, you know, sometimes the ideas always strike, you know, when you least expect it. So I have this habit of taking the photo, you know, and of what capture me, whether it's typography, color, fashion, design, and, you know, all the beautiful, interesting thing that can help me inform the next projects. Because, you know, I feel like the more vocabulary, the more collection that you have, you know, the better it's your design solution for the next client, because you've seen a lot. But it's not always just beautiful things. Sometimes I, you know, capture like a weird restaurant experiential or an art installation, for example, this kind that I shared. So as a, you know, creatives, it doesn't matter if you are a copywriter, designer, account executive, whatever you are in the advertising and design world, creative really needs to be visually fluent, right? It doesn't matter, you know, that some people say, oh, I'm a copywriter. I don't need to, you know, I've let the art director do all the art direction. I think we all have that responsibility to know what is going on in the world, what is a cool visual language, what is a trends in color, what is the look and feel, what kind of people that other campaigns is casting. So you need to always be a keen observer. And you might ask, Pum, how do you do it? The world is so insane, right? I mean, like when you go to town square or walk in any city, there's always stuff like thrown at you and you don't even see anymore. But I think, you know, as us, if you are the creative, whatever title you are, you always have to be visual fluent, because otherwise you're going to create some of the work that is, you know, it might have been done before. You want to understand what's going on so you can break that norm when you create your campaign. So today, rather than show a lot of stuff, I rather focus on maybe 2 to 3 projects and really dig deep with you guys of the process of how we at Design Army creating images for the client. You know, everything we do at Design Army, always kind of visual first campaign, because that's what we're good at. So let's start with the first kind of case study. Hong Kong Ballet came to us maybe 5 years ago to ask us to help them rebrand Hong Kong Ballet. At that time, the business was down. Not a lot of people go to the ballet. So when they hired the new artistic director, Septim Weber say, you know, we want someone outside Hong Kong to kind of articulate, you know, Hong Kong in a new way. So we got the project. So I asked the client, can you please send current and existing design of like, you know, what are you guys projecting for in terms of communication? What do you send to your patron? What kind of brochure and outdoor advertising you do? So this is what they sent to us. As you can see, it's Hong Kong Ballet and it's so disjointed. You know, sometimes they shoot in studio, sometimes they go on location. In terms of the design, it's all over the place. They use 20 different fonts. There's no design language that's consistent whatsoever. And the dancer, they don't have, like, you know, what I find is quite striking. Like, this is ballet company and it's all about movement and motion, and all the photo here is so static, you know, and then you portray the dancer in such a old way, you know, a guy wearing white leotard and girl in pink tutu. It's just very expected. And, you know, no wonder people look at this and like they don't engage. So our first campaign that we did for the client, it is 3 things that I want to solve with my teams, right? So number one, we want to make sure that the consistency of everything that come out of Hong Kong Ballet has to be the same. So we want to make sure we have the photography, visual language style, typography, design, art direction, it has to be much tighter. So, you know, so it's not all over the place. Second, we need to reach really big audience. Like, we can no longer, because the business is declining, we can no longer just focus on the patron who give, you know, money and to the ballet, but then you ignore the rest of the city. I mean, when you think about ballet, is not the first thing young people is going to go watch, right? I mean, you can go to concert, you can go to art museum. I mean, there's other thing to do. So ballet to a lot of people is not really accessible, and it has that kind of people think it's like only for the elite and it's not for everyone. So we need to create an image that much more accessible for everyone at all age. And third, this is Hong Kong Ballet. The name of the company is Hong Kong Ballet. So you need to create the sense of Hong Kong pride. You know, if you're not even like ballet, but at least you have to be proud of Hong Kong. So we pitched the idea that, you know, we need to do an outside campaign that is consistent and make sure that when you look at it, whether you like ballet or not liking ballet, you feel proud that you are like a Hong Kongian. So here's the final visual that we create for the campaign. This is run on outdoor advertising. Again, you know, when we first launched this campaign, we want to use female, but really show the female empowerment, you know, an army of dancers that stand in a very iconic architectural pose. Their hair even mimic the skyline behind them. So when you see it, it's quite striking. It's like a new visual image, brand image for the Hong Kong Ballet. The guy, you know, he's like, you know, let's take him out of those tights and prints and sore, you know, like this is not Disney. I mean, like we want Hong Kong to feel contemporary and cool. You know, when I see the dancer jump, especially men, they are really strong. It's like athletic, you know, it's like, let's like, you know, creating this cool visual of like two gangsters doing like the kung fu fight in Hong Kong in the most iconic Instagrammable place, but it's so familiar place where we shot it differently, you know, from the low angle, make them quite heroic, like they fly into the sky. Ballet can be witty and whimsical. People don't understand that, you know, there's a movement that created by dance. Dance is a language, you know, it can be like whimsical and funny language, right? So this is the a scene that we combine food and Hong Kong iconic restaurant called Jumbo Floating Restaurant, which recently, last month, this restaurant was shut down due to COVID. So I'm kind of sad about that. But it was great that we were able to capture the image at the moment in time. This one is, we were trying to communicate the like new generation, Gen Z, in front of something really old and ancient. So we shot this Gen Z dancer, but then really use symmetry, you know, to express the strength of the dance. And we even put her in the bob wig, which is round, mimic the round tutu, the red round tutu, and the circular door of the temple. So it's like that repetition, you know, we designed the photo before we go shoot. So this is not like, okay, let's just like put the dancer here. Everything in the photograph that I show you is very curated and designed and planned. This one, you know, of a visual image of a dancer flying into the air, like almost like a Renaissance painting to show how impactful and graceful the dance can be. And last picture, oops, how come this is not working? Oh, the last photo is, we didn't plan to use to shoot here before. And then when I went there and did some scouting and had a meeting with the producer, was like, why are we not shooting here? You know, this is like great place. And she's like, oh, it's dirty. It's kind of old. It's like, that's the point. It's authentic Hong Kong cuisine. We have to show like a Sha Sha Tam restaurant. So we threw, you know, another, figured out on set. We didn't sketch this out. That's the team, the artistic director. We were like, okay, what can we do with this space? Because it's like, this really feels authentically to Hong Kong. After that, we have to create a brochure that going to in the mail, and you know, as well as figure out a way to market each show from Alice in Wonderland, Great Gatsby, Giselle. So like, even though there's like 10 different shows throughout the entire year, we don't want each show to look different. So again, we sketch out of the art direction of how we want to communicate Alice in Wonderland, Giselle, You know, Hong Kong Cool, which is like a more modern dance, and the Nutcracker, the Great Gatsby. So all of them, you know, were shot at the same time and unified by the consistent typography. And literally we stripped all their font down and changed to one font only. We only use one font for Hong Kong Ballet, and you can express one font in different way. You know, type can be dynamic, 45 degree, you know, at Design Army, typography is our secret weapon. We spend a lot of time crafting the message and using the right type to, you know, help communicate the message. So that's the new look and feel of Hong Kong Ballet. As a result, after we launched the first campaign, it was, you know, mind blowing in terms of the press that we received, not only, you know, at Week or Creative Room, people in our industry, but like someone like CNN Travel, and people start using these images to advertise Hong Kong. You know, they call and ask like if we can use this photo, and I said, you know, go for it. And as a result, we didn't have like a big media buy necessary, but you know, the PR totally kind of like get the word out. Therefore, Hong Kong now is like one of probably the top three art organization in Hong Kong that, you know, the government helped funding because they see that, you know, how the ballet can be a good representation of the city. Funny story, 9 months later, after this campaign launch, I got like three texts from three of my friends in Asia at the same time. And everyone say, have you seen this? A company, Little Swan, which is a Chinese apparent company in China, did an ad campaign that obviously they say is inspired by the Hong Kong Ballet, but internet went crazy, right? People were at Week, Diet Prada was running an article of how crazy similar it is. The point I'm trying to make here is that, you know, this is why visual language, visual image is so powerful. Once you create one image one time, like United Color of Benetton, for example, or like this Hong Kong Ballet, once you create it and strike people at in the heart and the head, and they remember it, it's hard to, you know, forget about that image. Like it's kind of implanted into your brain. So in here, like that's why people was like, oh my God, it looks exactly the same. So it was kind of funny story for Hong Kong Ballet to get like another wave of PR. The second year that we worked with Hong Kong Ballet happened to be their 40th year anniversary, and the artistic director is like, okay, how are you going to outdo yourself, you know, with your team? You have to come up with something cool. And I thought, you know, unlike the first campaign, we will do the outdoor advertising and print, but also we have to do a video because this is about dance. We want people to really see the dance move, you know, in motion. But, you know, at first, we didn't even know what we're going to do, but I remember from my trip with my crazy Instagram photo that I shot, it's like, you know, this city has a very, very unique characteristic when it's come to color. And when people think of color, in especially in advertising, is like color, I mean, who talk about color as a concept, right? Color, when you think about it, really have a psychology, like it's color, like have like meaning in psychology and culturally, and without you knowing it, it's a very unconscious thing. You walk into the white room clean and make you feel different way to walk into like the hot pink room or the black room, you know, it does change the moods. So I thought, okay, we don't know what's the concept going to be. It doesn't need to be like overly clever, but we have to really take people through the journey of Hong Kong and use color and repetition, which is, you know, you find in building as like kind of like the core concept to creating this dance frame. And then we thought Hong Kong is, while it's very metropolitan city, it's also very kind of contradict and paradox city at the same time. So we thought, can we mix things that doesn't really make sense together, like ballet on a basketball court, can be used the classic music, Barrello song, and twist it to the hip hop music and twist it with the Chinese music, blend in fashion and food, bring beauty and humor together, use pastel color from Hong Kong and interject with neon, and grandma traditional with, like, you know, she's playing with emoji. So let's take a look at the film, and then I will do a breakdown of how we came up with the film. So that's our Never Standing Still campaign. And, you know, how did we do it? Everything that Design Army teams do when we come to a movie like this, we always start with a sketch, super like primitive black and white sketch like this. And we sell the idea to the client, which is a pure black and white sketch. When we have the sketch, we ask the producer in Hong Kong to find a location that has repetition, you know, whether it's sidewalk, repetition of lines, because dance is about repetition, right? You see dancer into the role, and we want to kind of design the film in a way that like mimic the city of Hong Kong. And then also ask her to find a place that has like beautiful pastel color to, you know, get that mood and feeling so the whole film feel authentic. Clothing, wardrobe is super important. We had we worked with a costume designer at Hong Kong Ballet to creating the costume for the whole entire cast. So for me, costume is like a way to express the emotion within this dance film. And how we do it, you see the black and white sketch. What we did was putting the location into the sketch along with the composition of the dance. I mean, you know, at that time the choreographer has not choreographed it yet, but then we do storyboard everything out so he know exactly what he has to choreograph. So for example, frame 49, here is the scene of the Chinese dance scene that is going to transition to the basketball court. You've got the fan. We want to create like the fan dance that it turn into like the round circle, and then you move to scene 50, which is a top view of the 2-2 dancer, right? Where the drone come up and taller and higher and higher, you start seeing the dancer form that emoji dance, and then emoji face on page 52 translate to 53, you know, with O shape. So, you know, all here, like Design Army teams really kind of like think of each frame as its own little story and how things is transitioned together. So in a way we are designing the film, you know, with through the design lens. So on here, before we go to Hong Kong, we put this together. So that when, you know, it's helped kind of do animatic, then that way everyone is on the same page in terms of camera angle and how long the dance that for each scene has to be. Once the team flew into Hong Kong, we have 4 days of pre-production, and of course everything went wrong, right? We had a monsoon coming through Hong Kong at the time, so the whole entire 4 day was raining the whole entire time, and the dancer, the grandma, one it's like a very simple move, it's like swim dance, and she couldn't like sync with the other girl. So things always go wrong at production, but you always have to kind of keep positive thinking, positive spirit to your team. Otherwise, things gonna fall apart. So look at something behind the scenes. I mean, it's like that the whole time. You would never be able to see that. So, you know, this when you are the creative director that lead the whole crew of 150 people, you got to be able to think on your feet. You know, the rain is coming. We didn't get the permit to shoot in that intersection, but we really want to shoot in that intersection. So we did like a quick rehearsal. You have like about 15 seconds for each take. So we have to like literally wait until traffic to go by and then go back again. So, you know, keep things positive. That's what we do as the creative director, right? Anyway, so when we got the film back from the director, of course, version one on the far left is miserable. The whole place was raining and it was dark and stormy. So we worked with company three, which is they're excellent with color grade. And they was like, we can fix that. They came back to version two. It is much brighter, more vivid. And they were like, okay, we got it. I was like, not really, guys. It does not feel like Hong Kong is too bright because Hong Kong is pastel. So as creative person, you got to be able to articulate exactly what you want. So we went to version three, which is like brighter. And, you know, they thought they were done. And it was a really hard job to color grade this one. And I'm like, no, this is like 40th anniversary Hong Kong. We don't want it to look like a current Hong Kong. We want to make it feel like futuristic Hong Kong. So version four is like the futuristic Hong Kong, where when you look at it, it feels like you are in the future, 2050, the temperature is right, 72 degree and crisps. So like, I mean, you have to have a keen eyes when you design a film, especially, you know, art director here. Who that's your job. I mean, your job is to be able to get exactly how you see it in your head, and the way to communicate to your design partner, creative partner, is to like really know how to communicate, you know, in a very articulate way, right? So as you can see here, there's a huge difference between version one and version four. So sweat every details, it's very important. This is print campaign. Again, you know, we show the sketch to the client. We didn't even know if they're going to be able to stand with one hand or, you know, jump at the same time. But a lot of time, you know, when you sketch, you kind of dream up your concept, you know, dream up your idea, and don't let reality stop your dream. Like, go crazy, sketch out crazy. And, you know, when you present to the client, somehow they will find a way to make it work. So this is final key visual for Hong Kong 40th year anniversary, Never Standing Still campaign. Again, you know, we got a really great response after this campaign. There's a huge increase in subscription, went up to 150%. And we got all kind of press, like beyond to just like dance and advertising or and design publication. But what I really most proud of is when this article came out, you know, at that time when we launched this campaign, Hong Kong has a lot of, it has gone through a really tough time because they have a lot of big protests and, you know, with mainland China. The images that projecting at that time, anything that comes out from Hong Kong was like tear gas, people are crying, someone is getting hurt, police is fighting. You know, as a creative team, you know, we were able to project a very positive image of Hong Kong to, you know, to the entire world. So that's your power. That's our power. You know, as the creative people, we can project anything that positive, you know, that in our head to the culture outside. Now, people might be saying, you know, Pum, it's easy to do something for Hong Kong Ballet because it's like art organization and they understand like style and fashion, the music and stuff. I believe, you know, if you are a good creative, it doesn't matter who your clients are, you always find a way and solution to make a brand relevant. This is another example. A client of mine called Georgetown Optician, you know, and they are eye doctors. Eye doctor is not the sexiest or fun, you know, people. How do you brand, how do you rebrand an eyewear company, right? So Georgetown Optician, they went through kind of business repositioning to not only, you know, creating that medical service, which is, you know, you go to see your eye doctor, get your eye check, and then you get prescription, you take prescription out somewhere and you go buy glasses at Bloomingdale's or Neiman Marcus or Nordstrom or whatever. They want to reposition themselves as one-stop shopping optician. So you get your eye checked, but then when you come outside, it's a very cool fashion frame, eyewear, sunglasses that you can shop and you can get your eye checked at the same time. That's a difficult assignment. How do you make optician sexy? How do you make optician and rebrand, recreate that image to be the destination of all things eyewears, right? Of fashionable eyewears. So we came up with the concept called Eyes Say More Than Words, Joy the Silent Revolution. And we shot this at the library in Baltimore, but you know, and when we look at this photo, it's almost like you don't know where it is. But let's take a look at the film and then I can walk through you guys through the process.
A sanctuary of silence, a temple of hush. Welcome to the quietest library on earth. A place where silence is zealously guarded. And noise is zealously punished. Here, expressive eyes and animated eyewear do the talking more eloquently than words.
Shh, 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 shh.
thoughts are communicated with blinks, winks, and eye-catching frames. Secret plots are hatched with furtive glances through fabulous glasses. Silent revolutions are planned with revolutionary eyewear and radical style. And tormentors are toppled without so much as a word being fired. Say more than words. Join the silent revolution. Georgetown optician.
So that's, you know, another example of use of visual first campaign, but then obviously we decide once we have the visual, then we work with the sound designer to design the sound to help articulate the quiet library on earth where you can hear everything. And, you know, there's a lot of design on here. You see all the book jacket or the clothing, the hairstyles. Like we try to show as many glasses as possible in this film. And then, you know, the glasses, sometimes it's like a cat eye from the 50s and the 70s, the modern glasses. And we are giving that distinct personality to each character to help, you know, but there's different kind of consumer who come to Georgetown optician. There's kids, there's older gentlemen, women, girls, guys, and so forth. So we want to make sure that when they look at this ad, they see our product and also, you know, inspire, you know, to come and really think of Georgetown optician differently, that, you know, it is a really cool and creative company. And always, you know, I like to always throw like the weirdness into any movie. This is one of the scene of the clock tower turning into the eyeball. I mean, that's something like that. You can't really unseen it. You know, once you see it, you remember it. And that's what I always strive for. The design always, you know, very important to us. The design of the in the movie and the graphic design on the point of purchase at the store also, you know, remain consistent. And again, you know, how is that carried through on Instagram? So we don't lose any beat, right? Like once we've done the movie, we pay close attention to the design on the print and digital that, you know, it has the same 360 feeling of every touch point that you touch with the brand. And lastly, I'm going to go through this really quickly. As a designer, you have an ability to help the client create product. Nina Paper in Atlanta asked us, our team, to creating a new color and texture of the new Nina Classic paper. And, you know, how do you create product? How do you create the product like paper? You know, what color of paper are we creating for the client? What texture are we creating? So again, you'll get back to the beginning of this presentation. I am a visual collector. So I went back to the collection of my photo that I travel and really find a uniformity color that's always classic, you know, the classic red and cobalt blue and epic black. So all those colors, we help the client creating a series of products, you know, beginning with painting the color, the desirable color first. Then we work with scientists to create the color, and he create recipe to produce thousands and thousands of pounds of paper. And this paper today are used in like shopping bag packaging and box for, you know, big company like Cartier, Coca-Cola, and so forth. So, you know, even though I don't design, it's kind of fun to like be able to design the paper itself and deep with the client on the R&D product. Then it's come to advertising campaign. You know, we look at different era of art and design to really create the new meaning of classic. We want classic to feel current. So, you know, we kind of reinterpret the Art Deco era, the Renaissance, the modern mod era and all that. And then we're creating this key visual for the brand. So this is new campaign called Think Classic for Nina Paper. And it has three different kind of division, classic crest, classic linen, and classic texture. Here's are some of the paper promotion that we are sending to brands. You know, every brands like have in-house designer, and you know, whether you work at Cartier or Tiffany or Chanel, you know, that you always have to do some sort of invitations and packaging and direct mail to consumer. So this is, you know, the campaign that really showcasing the new color that we created, as well as, you know, explain, you know, why do you use different shades of whites to print the full color process? So it's much more technical information, but we make it artful for our target consumer who's our, you know, in-house designer. And again, you know, this was carried through the social media, even though it's paper, it also has to work digitally too. So I just want to end with, you know, I went in quite detail of like how do we creating certain thing, because I want to emphasize that it's so important to be so obsessed with what you do. You know, it is a quest for perfection, which make your work even better and better. I think, you know, sometimes I think this day anyways, like we are always in the rush and we kind of lose that craftsmanship. And you know, you guys are the next generation of creative leader, and I want to make sure like don't lose sight of the depth of the work that you create. And also the other thing is like don't be afraid of bring out your idea, right? I mean, the process of Design Army, we always think about like, you know, a process of creating project is like, you know, to dream up something. So whatever you have in your head, you know, you got to be able to articulate and sell that to the client. So, you know, don't be afraid to get and be fearless, you know, when it comes to presenting idea to your boss or your client. I think it's better to go over the top than, you know, try to like worry that the client's not going to go that far and they might not like this. And I think there's always, it's much easier to turn down the volume than to turn up the volume. So whatever you dream up, you know, get your idea out there. And I can't wait to see what you guys are gonna come up with the new generation of creative like yourself. I think you guys have some really great idea. So thank you so much, everyone. This is one of my favorite quote of all time by my hero. When you make something no one hates, no one loves it either. So don't care about what other people think. Just do your thing. Thank you. Yes, ask question. This is, you know, make it. This is safe space. So any question you have, you know, ask me.
Yeah, I have one actually. Thank you for sharing. The content is very interesting. Congratulations for the work. I love
our team. Thank you so much. You're very kind.
I love everything about it. And no, just to introduce myself, I'm Alexandre Cazu. I work in Boston, but I'm Brazilian. And no, one thing that I was thinking is it's very hard to convince a client of a new idea, because and you share your ideas, your visual ideas with sketches. This is very hard for us because they never. How can I say, the clients are unable to visualize how it will be. And of course, we fill them with a lot of references and everything, but presenting in a sketch for them, for the majority of our clients, is very hard. How do you do this? Is it easy? I don't know. Tell us a little bit about your clients and the process.
Well, the process, okay, there's two questions here. There's a process and how do I sell to the client, right? So the process, I think I just did an interview with someone, and I think, okay, I'll share the process with you. So I think a couple of my teams are here too, and from the Design Army. The process is very simple. We don't do a lot of like a big advertising agency kumbaya brainstorming session. The process is that, like, I would brief a project to the whole entire team. Everyone go their separate way to dream, you know, to dream about your idea. And I think when you dream, you do dream, you dream alone, you don't dream as a group. So, like, you know, you, if with the same brief, you give it to 10 people, each one go dream alone, and there is not one answer. Then a week later, we come back and we all share our dream. Okay, let's go. Tony, what's your dream? You know, Yeri, what's your dream? It's kind of like, and then we come together and looking at like which one is like resonate, you know, the dream that is like really interesting story to tell. And sometimes there's crossover. Sometimes there's like one really weird, bizarre one that can be good. And the reason that we don't do a brainstorming session like most ad agencies is that sometimes there's always like one or two people who can talk or articulate it better, right? In the meetings, like, okay, you guys, what are we thinking? Okay, let's do this. And then you might conclude it too soon. So when you do this and everyone have equal opportunity, they have equal seat on the table to share their dream. And when you dream, use the word dream because it's, we want something deep internally, right? And someone who was born and raised in Korea is going to have much different background than someone that born and raised in Toronto. And that, I think that our team is very collective, you know, of ideas. We dream together and then we kind of paste the story together. And let's say the Hong Kong ballet is like some of the scene and the restaurant is interesting. Oh, the basketball court is also cool. And you kind of stitch the dreams together and present concept to the client. And you know, we do only show the black and white storyboard to the client because I don't want to spend a lot of time executing an idea that the client doesn't buy into. Now, showing the sketch is crucial. A, you have to be able to present the sketch, which is tough to do, but you know, I think as young creative, on your way up to one, if your dream is to be like running a vice president of creative in big ad agency, whether you like it or not, you need to learn how to present your idea. And how do you present an idea? You have to believe in your idea and you have to be able to articulate or what that means, bring excitement, you know, to the client. And maybe, you know, do if they can envision, draw a tight black and white drawing with the storyboard attached. You know, like here's a story, because you want original story, it needs to be original, something exists, not exist before. Here is the mood, you know, the look and feel, and you know, have them, you know, they need to go along the journey with you. So it's up to us, like, you know, how we present the work to the client. Does that make sense? But you know, I've been doing this for a long time. It does take time for young creative to present. I mean, I used to be so shy. Imagine English was my second language, but I think clients are so open now. Like don't let for the international designer here, please don't let the language to make you feel inferior than others English speaking language. That has nothing to do with it. It's all come down to the work and the work only. So.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Thank you very much.
As you've heard, my name is Anne Marie. I'm a young creative from Kenya, down in Africa. So I've really learned a lot from the session. Thank you so much for sharing. I've learned especially the importance of consistency in creative work. And mm-hmm. I think I'll carry that along my journey as I grow. But my question was, have you had to work on projects that didn't quite succeed? And how was that like for you and your team? But especially for you, even when you were starting.
Say that again. What's the question? I don't know. It depends on how you define success, right? And I mean, throughout 20 years at Design Army, of course, not everything is LIA International Gold winner or Cannes Lions winning piece, right? There's level of projects that, you know, some, I think you have to be able to let go. I mean, certain client, you know, as much as you want to push, sometimes they afraid, you know, and they afraid to that there is not going to be a piece that respond well for their consumer, or it went too, like it's too much to for their overboard. I mean, all we can do is like do the best that we can, but then if the stuff doesn't get picked and doesn't get, you know, forward to get produced, I think it's, you have to move on. Like, I think you can't just sit down and be sad and cry and think about, you know, that piece. I think, you know, we have opportunity every day. You know, I tell, as a young designer, when I was young, when my stuff doesn't get picked, I of course get crushed. Like, man, I spent so much time in it. And, you know, why did they not get picked? But then if you just sit down and question like the why, how can you move on to the next project? So I had this theory when I was a younger designer, like the best project that I ever gonna be working on is the project that is on my desk right now. Because I have control. I have control of what is the outcome of my future gonna be. So like, even though it was not success in the past, the one that I have right now is going to be my next move. It's going to be my next piece. So you always have to focus on the present and the future. You know, same way, like, you know, the Hong Kong Ballet was extremely successful. I don't want to like, yeah, we had done stuff successful. This is great, you guys. As a team, we got to move on. Like, you can't just sit down and feel like you are at the very top of the mountain because we are successful at what we do. You always have to tell yourself like, we in the middle of the mountain, and as a team we are going like to reach the new goal. So you always like, you know, disrupt yourself. Like, don't be afraid to disrupt yourself. Like, don't get comfortable with yourself either, because like our industry is always changing, the world is changing, the mediums are changing. So learning and tell yourself that you're going to have to learn and relearn many, many times in your career is the way to go. And I share your, you know, I'm sure as a young designer, there's a certain thing that you work so hard on and it did not get picked. I think you have the eyes toward the future than, you know, something that happened in the past. I think that should be the focus, and keep things positive. Absolutely. Other question?
Yeah. I'd like to first of all, thanks for sharing your work. It's amazing. I'm Kazu's partner. I'm Lucas Ribeiro. I'm Brazilian copywriter, and especially being a copywriter, like talking to designers, mm-hmm. I'm always trying to find like a balance, because I believe that the work or advertising, the world is becoming more like visual. Mm-hmm. And I also understand that is an importance for language and like visual language, but I'm always trying to find a balance and to bring more importance to like the words. And I'd like to hear you from you. I don't know, what do you think about it? Like, how can we make the words as important as the visual? Like, because as I told you, like, I'm a copywriter, so I want to hear from you as a designer. How is your point mm-hmm. of view on these? And yeah.
Really good question. I'm not saying that the visual from this presentation, I'm not saying that the visual is more important than copy. I'm just saying that how we at Design Army think, because like, you know, the people who work at Design Army are like probably background as an artist, and they get into this industry because they are like artists and they become designers. So the way they think, you know, they're thinking with drawing. So like me, as an example, not even my team, like when I go to the client meeting or brief, they would say something and I would write a couple words, not so much sentence, and then I draw. So I take the information and I draw it. I take information and I draw it. So that's our output. Whereas you take the information and you write it. And, you know, Sam, who's in my team and see here too, she's a writer. So, you know, you take it for, so I love good copywriting. And there's a difference between the first campaign that I show you that is just visual first, sound design, no word, right? Because it's Hong Kong ballet, versus a Georgetown optician. That's also visual first, but the copywriting is so good. If you like look at it again, the copywriting is make things very understandable. You know, it's like, because the visual first is all, like abstract art. It's like, okay, like you have to make the interpretation. When the word that come in and pair perfectly with visual, it creates a sense of unity and clarity for the campaign. You know, eyes say more than word, right? Silent revolution. I mean, it's like the word is what sum up that whole entire movie. So copy is so important. I love good headline. Sam, do you have anything to add?
Hi everyone. No, I mean, Pum, I think that's you do love a good headline. But I love that the visual always informs the headline. That's always such a powerful way to start. So I'll leave it at that.
But I love and sometimes though, like even we create a recent campaign for athletic shoe, the visual is so good. But it's like, what's the messaging? And then like we work with a copywriter and he came up with a tagline that is so tight. It's like, oh my God, that's so good. You know, a copy has so much value to the visual. And when the tool is really strong, it's even better, in my opinion.
I'm sorry to jump in and to ask again, but and how to describe or how to tell a client an idea that is like basically visual. And I understand that there is a line at the end, but how to like to tell a client to explain a script that is so visual.
You have to be, like you have to be really good teacher. Remember like when you were young and you have teacher who you go to school and he just teach like, and there's a teacher who's just like, once upon a time, there's this world of, you got to act it out, like take acting class if you have to. You need to be like, let's say if you don't have your partner and he does not know, like you don't have your partner and you have to sell the idea, you can sell with your word, but you have to tell the story in a way that the client would understand. You have to take them through the journey. For me, client presentation is not a presentation. You are taking the client to a creative journey with you, taking them to that ride and taking them to that, you know, ideas. And in a way, they should feel like they are part of the creative process too. Not just like they are being pitching to the idea. So they're going to be like, yes, no, maybe, I don't like it. And then we all like crush. And I think that's why we show the sketch, because it's more like a process rather than like a final product, a final execution. Yeah. So how can copywriters sell the work? You got to act it out.
Great.
Make act like the script is like you said, the perspective, like the old man's voice. Once upon a time, you know, we are taking you through the journey of, I mean, like, you know, don't make a presentation you know, don't put on the presentation, you have to put on a show, and it has to be entertaining.
Yeah.
When you sell the idea.